Well, yeah, come on, let's go. Y'all ready? Yeah. I like that energy. Thank you for bringing that. Well, good morning. Welcome, everybody, to SouthCrest. Welcome, LaGrange. Welcome, Newnan. We're going to have some fun. We're in a brand new series called Roots. And so we're going to be talking about how to find real spiritual progress in our lives. And so this is going to be a good series. I'm really excited about it. So I'm going to jump right in here. It's springtime, fun time, right? Project time, time to do a little spring cleaning maybe around the house. So Jachin and I, man, we got in the mood. You know, the bug has bitten us. Even though it doesn't really feel quite like spring right now, we're still jumping all the way in. So we are doing projects around the house right now. And one of the things that we do is, I don't know what it is, but about this time every year, we feel like we have to completely rearrange everything in the house. Are you guys with me on this? I mean, are you jumping in with me? I mean, so like we'll be like starting with just a little bit of laundry, right? You know, just, hey, let's fold some laundry. Before I know it, we've got everything off in the closets, on the floor. We're like refolding, washing everything. We're rearranging the whole entire closet. Like, what is going on here? What has happened? 4 hours later, I'm elbow deep in laundry and we're like, when did this take place, you know? And so one of the things that we like to do is we like to, I don't know, do something about the living room, you know? Like when I walk into my living room, I feel like I'm like, I don't like the way this is laid out anymore, okay? So the springtime is when I just wanna move it all around. And so what we'll do is I've got like a couch and two chairs and the thing where the TV hangs and like a table. There's not a whole lot of options there, but I feel like whatever, I need to just move it all around. And so two people making decisions while you're doing this, that's always fun because you got one person who says, okay, let's put the couch over here, the two chairs are here, we're gonna leave the middle wide open, you know, TV right there, and you kind of sit down, and you just admire it for a little while, you know? You kind of look at it, and then the other one comes in, absolutely not, I hate the way this feels, we gotta move this table over here, we're gonna switch it all around, take that picture, move it over there, and it's like, we're just kind of going round and round in circles. Meanwhile, I'm like picking up heavy couches, you know, moving them, and Jackie's like, no, more to the right, okay, just a little bit more over there, and like this, she's like, no, okay, go back, and so that's just kind of the way we do it. But here's the funny thing about the way that we're rearranging the furniture, right, is that it's all the same furniture. Okay? I mean, maybe we get one picture or something like that to throw on the wall or a candle to light, but for the most part, it's all the same stuff. And you get done and you admire it, and you're like, man, this feels great. You know, it's like a whole new room. Maybe you come in there, you like, one of your friends do this, you go to their house, you're like, what have you done to the place, man? This looks great, but it's all the same stuff. It's exactly the same. I do this with my motorcycle too, right? I got a Harley Davidson. How many Harley guys or motorcycle guys we got out there? Come on, one or two of you. Yeah, come on, gentlemen. So, yeah, I do this on my bike. You know, I've got my motorcycle. I love it, man. I ride it on sunny days, and I'm a fair weather motorcycle rider. I just gotta confess, okay? I'm not a hardcore guy, but I'll do this. Like, I'll switch out a mirror or something on there, or like, man, I like those tailpipes. I'm gonna get some new pipes on there, or you know, I'm always thinking about painting the bike, you know, or one thing or the other. But I'm not ever really changing anything mechanically to the bike. I just want to get a new accessory and make it feel new, right? So that's sometimes I feel like what we do is we want to change things up. Spring's a time where we like to change things up. But here's the difference. We got to be careful because spiritually sometimes we want to do this as well. We get the feeling like, you know what, I just need to mix it all up. I kind of feel this sense where things are a little bit stale, things are getting a little lax. And so I'm just gonna change everything up in my life. Maybe I'll start a new Bible reading plan. Maybe I'm gonna memorize that whole chapter in Ephesians. I'm just gonna do that. So I get that new Bible memorization app, right? And I throw it on my phone. Or maybe I'm gonna do a new devotional plan, right? I'm gonna get a brand new devotional book and I'm gonna go for it this time. I'm really gonna make it happen. Like I'm gonna see the growth that I wanna see. And see, but the problem is that we just keep changing things around. And what I've noticed personally in my spiritual life is that there's a difference between change and real spiritual progress. You know what I'm talking about? Because there's a lot of times where we can change things around, we can mix things up, but it's difficult for us to fill in the real gaps in our lives. Have you noticed that? Have you noticed your gaps? I've noticed mine. You know, me and my girls, they play soccer. And I love to play soccer. I grew up playing soccer. And so I got them all, like, where I was coaching them for a few seasons, and they were all, after practice one day, they were like, okay, Dad, let's see what you got. And so three or four of them got in there like, okay, we're gonna all play you, Dad. It's like us versus you. And so I was like, okay, let's do this. And so then, so I started playing with my daughters, you know, and then a couple of their friends. So like three or four people, they're on the team. And it's me by myself versus them. And I'm doing pretty good, you know, like I'm doing tricks and spins around them. I'm making them, pushing kids down, you know, I'm killing them. And so it's going really good. And then like some other kids see the fun and they're like, oh yeah, everybody gang up on the old guy, you know, like, so then their team turns into like a massive mob and there's like 30 kids on the field. And I'm like, now I'm afraid I really am going to hurt some child, you know, like, because I can't move. Like, and so I just get slaughtered. Like, they destroy me. And so we get in the car later on, and Sophie's like, hey, Mom, guess what? And Mom's like, hey, what's up, babe? And she's like, yeah, we just killed Dad in soccer. And I'm like, what? Like, whoa, hold on one minute. You know, you just killed me in soccer. There were 30 of you. First one, you know, what is happening here? And so then I was like, all right, let's get this straight. So I began to break down to her exactly what it was going to mean for her to actually win. I was like, here, you've got a long way to go, my dear, before you're actually going to be able to beat me. I just wanted to, that's what good parenting does, right? Just make sure that they understand how far they've got to go. But here's the deal. Don't we do that? I think that sometimes we delude ourselves this way when it comes to our own spiritual progress. Am I right? I mean, we imagine ourselves to be a lot farther along than we actually are. I know that I do this. And here's when it shows up in my life. It's like, you know, my overreactions are sometimes epic, you know? I don't know what if it's just dads or what. It's like you're kind of going along and you're saying, I'm going to have an awesome day. I'm going to nail this day. Like, I'm going to do the best day I've ever had. And you come home and you're like, you know, you're feeling pretty decent about the day. And then everything starts to happen at home. And like kids are running around, you're trying to prepare dinner. And then, but you're holding it together, you know, like I'm going to keep this together. You run over here. I'm going to keep. And then, you know, but then the escalation continues to happen. And then it's bedtime. And I got to say, I love reading to my children at bed. If they would just listen to the actual book that I'm reading, right? It's like, you're sitting there, you're trying to read a story, and then you're like three words in, and then here's talking and jumping out of bed, and I need some water. And they're like, what is going on? Like, can you not, I am a loving father trying to read to my children. Can you please keep it together? Exactly, so that's what, but you know, but we overreact, right? Nudge somebody next to you if they overreact, okay? If you're sitting next to an overreactor, if they ever do that, just give them a little nudge, like in a loving way. Okay, so here's the deal. We've got some, not a punch, just a nudge. So we've got gaps, right? And here's the reality. We try and hide them, or maybe we overreact to them, but we know we've got them. We've got gaps. And so here's the question. What do we do about our gaps? How do we see real spiritual progress in our lives? I think that if most of us were honest, we would admit that we're actually far from where we know we could be, maybe even who we want to be, possibly who we know we should be, right? We're far away from that person. And we've tried a lot of things. Maybe you've tried switching groups. Maybe you've tried switching churches, switching friends, trying a new Bible study. Not any of those are necessarily bad things. But we keep cycling through the different spiritual exercises. And for some reason, true spiritual change, real progress, has eluded us. I think that's sometimes what we feel in reality when it comes to our spiritual walk. And so, let's all say it. Let's say together, I got gaps. Say, I got gaps. I got gaps. And you know, for me, it's definitely plural, gaps. I've got multiple gaps in my life, and I want to do something about those things. So, we're going to be starting this new series called Roots, and in this series, we're going to be talking about how to make real spiritual progress in our lives. We're even going to talk about different steps and stages that you're going to be able to see in your personal life, and you're going to be able to ask the question, okay, where am I really at in my walk, and how do I take the next step? That's what we're going to be talking about here in this passage, and the good news is this, guys. Here's the real good news. Jesus has taken the first step towards us. Amen? So look, here's the cool part. we're not going to have to go far because Jesus has already come to us. The God sent his son Jesus Christ into the world to save the world. And so Jesus has already made the first move. And so all we have to do is respond to him. So we have to respond to Jesus. So the question is, how will we respond? How will we respond? All right, we're going to look at a passage today that's going to help us answer some of these questions. It's in Matthew chapter 13. And if you want to flip there in your Bibles, that's great. I'm going to go ahead and pray for us, and then we're going to jump into the passage. God, we ask that you'd be with us this morning, Lord. Help us to be honest about where we're really at, God. Help us to have humility. Help us to see ourselves as we really are. And then help us to look to you and really be able to receive from you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so Matthew chapter 13. It's easy, just start in verse 1. So here we go. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat by the lake. Such large crowds gathered around him. That was very southern. Like, I just skipped the first A round. I just went right to round. I'm not sure why I did that, but there we go. The crowds gathered round him, and then he got into a boat and sat in it while all the people stood on the shore. And then he told them many things in parables. So let's pause right there. Okay, so we see that Jesus is here teaching. He gets up that day and he does what Jesus does. He goes out and he teaches people. And before the day gets going very long, there's already a large crowd there ready to listen to Jesus, which is pretty awesome, right? Like, to be able to stand up and get ready to teach, and there's already, you know, thousands of people there. So much so that he has got to get into a boat and go out a little ways to sea so that he can actually address everybody. Plus, your voice kind of carries a little better when it hits over water, and so he's kind of using that to his advantage as well. But Jesus has to go out into the sea on a boat to really even be able to discuss everything with these people. And he says, okay, we're going to talk about parables. So there's a crowd there wanting to listen, willing to listen. And here's a couple things about the crowd. I mean, who is in this crowd? There's a couple different characters that are sitting in this crowd, all right? There's some people who are there who are skeptical. They're like, Jesus, what you got to say today, man? Like, I mean, I'm here, but I'm also kind of picking apart everything you got to say right now. And some of those were religious people even. And they saw that the things that they had done in their lives, the religious things that they had lived and the way that they had lived in their lives, that they were going to hold Jesus according to whatever that standard was. So they had an immediate idea, this is how this should be done. And I'm going to see how he does, if he agrees with me or not. And that was the kind of people that they were. And they were skeptical and they were religious. And then there was other people that they were just haters, you know, like they just wanted him to lose. And there were some people who were really not for anything that had to do with God. And they were there and they were going to mock Jesus and they were going to scorn him, maybe some Romans, that they potentially could have been in the crowd as well. And then there were people who were intrigued by Jesus, but also not sure, not really ready to jump in. And then there were some people who were just like completely devoted and following Jesus and had already given him their full life. And so we got this crowd and lots of different people are in the crowd. And here's the deal. We're all coming from different places as well when it comes to our relationship with Jesus. Am I right? Man, we got people here. You're just starting out in your faith journey. You're excited. You're ready to go. And you're like, man, I just want to grow. Like, just tell me what to do and I'm just going to do it. And there's other of you here. And like, this is literally the first time you've been to church in a while. And maybe you like got invited by a friend or like there was like some cute girl that told you she was going to be here. You can't find her. And now you're just sitting there, you know, like, dang, I missed out. But you know what? That's cool too. We're just glad that you're here. And you're maybe trying to figure out who this Jesus guy is and you're exploring. And that's awesome. We're just glad you're here. We want to help you figure out how to take the next step, how to grow and how to take a step. And there's some of you here, you've been doing this Jesus thing for a long time, but you know what? Your family just got bigger. Or your situation's just changed. And you're like, man, I'm trying hard to figure out how to follow Jesus in this new season. With this new thing that I've got going on, you know, this added complexity to my life. How do I follow him in the midst of all that? And there's some of you who've been here a real, real long time and you've been following Jesus a real, real long time. And you're like, man, I've been there. I've done that. Like I've raised kids, you know, I've led stuff. I've been a group leader. I've been this, I've been that. And you're like, you know what? My spiritual life has kind of grown stale. And I don't know exactly what to do because I don't know how to take responsibility for myself. I kind of want to put the responsibility on somebody else, but I don't really know what to do. I'm just stuck. And so we're going to talk about all those different types of people And maybe you can identify with one of those places that I just talked about. And we're going to see how each of those people can take your next step. So I see four groups, and we're going to talk about these four groups of people over this parable. And the four groups are exploring Christ, knowing Christ, close to Christ, and Christ-centered. And that's what we're going to be talking about over this series. We're going to get in depth about those three areas and how to take your next step. So let's keep moving, all right? So it says a farmer, Jesus started to tell the parable, and this is the parable that we're going to get into this morning. He said, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched and they withered away because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plant. Still other seed fell on good soil where it produced a crop, 160 or 30 times what was sown. Whoever has ears, let them hear. Okay, so we're going to focus on the one part of the parable that talks about the seed that fell along the path. Okay? So you see, here's the thing about these soils. These soils, every single one of these soil, the place that they're scattered, represents a place that we are in Christ. And Jesus is telling this parable, and he's actually giving every single one of us a warning. He's saying, look, be careful what kind of heart you have. You see, what's clear, and Jesus goes on to explain this later on in Matthew 13, he says, the soil is the condition of your heart. And so it's very, very important when it comes to our spiritual progress, what is the condition of our hearts? Where's your heart at? Where's my heart at? And so each one of these soils are a different heart condition. And we're going to be talking today about the heart condition that happens when it falls along the path. So this is the soil that falls along the path. And what happens to the soil that falls along the path? Or the seeds that fall along the path, excuse me. What happens to the seeds that fall along the path? They get eaten up by the birds. And so we got seeds, we got soil, and we got birds. So here's the thing about parables, right? A parable is just a fun, unique story that talks about a spiritual truth. And so we've got to begin to interpret this, and actually Jesus does it for us. If you read on down in verses 18 and 19, we're not going to do it this morning, but Jesus actually gives the interpretation of the parable. And he says, look, the birds, that's the evil one. And he's going to snatch up that seed and grab it. The seed is spiritual truth. That's like truth of the gospel. It's truth of the kingdom of God and the way to live in the kingdom of God. And then the soil we already talked about is our hearts. And so that's what we're going to be taking a look at, is what is the condition of our hearts. Jesus is saying about this hard path. See, what a sower would do in that time. And everybody had gardens that day. Like, everybody was organic. They straight up lived that lifestyle. And so what would happen is when you were going out, a farmer would go out to sow his seed, is he would just be scattering it. And the way that they had their crop set up is there would be, like, you know, pretty big fields. And in the fields, within the field, there would be these little paths that they had cut through so that the sowers could go in and sow the seed, right? And so sometimes it would hit the good soil, but sometimes it would hit right there on the path. Okay? And so this is literally an organic illustration that Jesus is using to talk about how truth hits us. And what he's saying is we have to be careful. We have to beware of listening to Jesus with a hard heart. We have to be careful that is when we hear the word of God or hear the truth of God and then we just do nothing about it. That's really what he's talking about here. When it falls along the path, the birds, the enemy, come quickly and snatch it away. And so he says, be careful to listen to the truth of Jesus without a hard heart. So what does that mean? What does it mean to have a hard heart? Well, here's the thing. The seed in this situation doesn't even have a chance to take root in our lives. And here's the truth, is that spiritual truth can't ever change us if it doesn't have the opportunity to take a root in our life. Spiritual truth can't change us unless it has the opportunity to take root in our lives. What does that mean? Well, we don't give it an opportunity when we actually don't stop to listen. And I know this is very basic. It seems simple, but it's actually very important. Because here's what happens, is that spiritual truth hits us. We hear it with our ears, we receive it, and we have an opportunity. Are we going to do something with that? Are we going to respond to it? First of all, are we going to listen to it? And then are we going to respond? And every one of us have that opportunity. And the question is, what is the condition of our heart? Are we willing and open and ready to receive it? Or are we closed and into a place that we can't listen or perceive or understand? You see, in order to take any spiritual step, we have to be willing to listen to the truth with open hearts. In order to take any spiritual step, that's wherever you are this morning. You know, you might be brand new Christian or not even following Jesus. From all the way to, dude, I've been doing this for a long time. In order to take any spiritual step, we have to be willing to listen to the truth with open hearts. This is very important because if you think about it, even right now, right? Even right here in this moment, I gotta tell you, when it comes to sermons and truth and listening and reading, my brain can be 1,000 different places, right? I mean, some of you may right now even be thinking, dude, I've left the stove on, right? I need to go. My wife always thinks that she has left her curling iron on. Like every single time we get away from the house, maybe not every time, but there's many times where we get away from the house, she's like, I'm pretty positive I left the curling iron on. I'm like, honey, you've actually never done that. Like, you've never really actually done that. I mean, you've thought you've done that about 1,000 times, but it's never actually happened. She's like, we gotta go home. We gotta turn around right now. I'm like, okay, let's go turn around. Let's check this out. Or like, you know, that's just kind of the way our brains work is we get divided or we're thinking of our laundry list or we're thinking about lunch or whatever. It's just sometimes so hard to stay tuned in, to listen, and to be willing to receive. It's a challenge. I do this all the time. I'm talking on the phone and like with my wife and the car, you know, this is like the worst thing that we can do, guys, right? Maybe not the worst, but one of the really bad things that we can do. You're talking on the phone with your wife and then what are you doing, right? You're on the phone, but you're also what? You're working, right? You're at the office, you're on your computer and you're like, yeah, baby, I know. Uh-huh, that's awesome. The girls did what? Cool. And then at some point, you know, and there's this pause in the conversation, like a long pause. And you like, you know, you're in trouble in that moment, right? Because you're like, I think I may have just answered a question from like 10 minutes ago. And she just asked, like the other day I did this with Jackie and she was like, honey, you know, telling me about her business and like all these cool things she's doing. And then I kind of zone out, you know, and then I come back in. I'm like, baby, you're killing it in your business. She's like, I wasn't even talking about that. You don't even care about me. I'm like, no, I mean, whatever you just said, I love you, honey. You're the best. Wait, what were we talking about? But we do this, right? We get divided and we try and do multiple things and it's like we have actually got to stop and really listen and listen with open hearts. I mean, think about leadership in the world today, right? Leadership in the world. It's not that we're here to listen or to hear, right? Leadership in the world today is here to gain a hearing. I mean, if you think about it, right? We're trying to elect the leader of America right now. In the middle of the whole election process, which, you know, our options are narrowing, but here's the deal. Here's what's, they're getting elected based on their ability to convince us, right? Based on their ability not to hear, not to listen, but to get a hearing. And that's the way we think that leadership works. That's the way that power works, is that you're not here to actually stop and listen to other people. Matter of fact, the longer you do that, the weaker that you are. We're here, if we want to lead, if we want to rule in this day and age, it's because we have certainty. It's because we're on top of our game. It's because we're here to tell people what they need to think, right? Not to actually be willing to receive. And so some of us have not been able to progress really in our spiritual lives because we think the kingdom of God ought to operate the way the kingdom of this world does. But you know what? They're two totally different realities. And the truth is, unless we're willing to listen and we're open to receive, we can't make progress in our spiritual lives. We just can't. And we can get stuck. And you can be anywhere in the process, and if you stop listening, you will get stuck and you will stop growing. So, Jesus is asking us, do you really know what you're getting into here? Have you really heard me? Are you really entering into my kingdom? Or are you just trying to get me to serve you in your kingdom? Have you really understood what this is all about? Make sure that you have heard. When it comes to spiritual progress, we have to be willing to listen with open hearts. You know, this is even different than having an open mind, right? Because an open mind is when I'm open about an idea for everybody out there, right? I am open to driving a Prius, right? I'm open about that. Man, I am really open about driving a Prius. I'm not actually going to do that myself, but I've got an open mind about that. And that's the difference between having an open mind and about what this is talking about. It's like, that's great for somebody out there, man. That's great for you. I'm glad that works for you. That's good for you. But actually, I never make it personal, right? I never make it about me. Have you ever had that moment where truth has just stared you in the face? Like where it's just kind of grabbed you by the throat. And you realize, maybe with excitement and thrill, you're just like, that's for me. Man, that was God speaking to me. Like, this is not about somebody out there. This is about me personally. God wants me to do something about this. That's what we're talking about here. It's about taking all the truth that's out there that's really good and saying, right here, this is for me. This is personal. I'm gonna make this real in my life. That's how to start your journey towards spiritual progress. Because here's the deal, there are many people who have seen the way of Jesus as purely theoretical. It's a great idea. It's a good concept. It's good for the world, man. But they've never actually made it personal. And guys, that's the way every single piece of truth in the kingdom of God works. It always starts when we make it personal for me. That's the beginning point. That's the first step. And so when we do this, we're willing to say, no, this is for me, not just for everybody, but this is for my life, for my reality, for my relationships, for my spouse, as a husband, as a wife, as a child. You know, this is for me right here. I need to make this decision right now for that thing or for this reality or for my boss or for my job, the way that I act, the way that I think, the way that I respond. This is for me. That's when we get on the true path towards spiritual progress. You see, this kind of truth never stays theoretical. And when we see it and when we experience it, it becomes extremely practical. Like you can't not stay unpractical. You can't not get practical with this. This is like, it has to make its way out in your real life in practical steps for you day in and day out. Listen to James. He said it this way. He said, "Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard, but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do." You see, in the end, when we listen with our heart, it always leads to doing. So I want to do something here in closing. All right, I have put under your chairs a little present for you, okay? So there's a rock in LaGrange. Your rock is probably sitting in your cup holder. But right here in Newnan, just look under your chair. I want everybody to grab this rock out right now. Okay? Everybody grab this rock. Here's what I want you to do with it, okay? Do me a favor. Grab it, and I want you to squeeze it tight in your hands. Okay? That's right. Squeeze it. Squeeze it out. Just hold it right there and squeeze it. Okay, so what happens to the truth, the seed that falls along the path? You remember what happens? It says the enemy comes and does what? Snatches it away. You know what that word actually means? It means grab. Okay, so here's what I think we are doing with our lives. We are holding on, right? This rock that I've asked you to hold on to, just think of that as your life. All right? That's your decisions, your choices, your will, your emotions, everything. It's right there. Your plan. Okay? This is your plan. And you're squeezing it. You got it tight. Truth outside of you wants to come in and penetrate. And what happens? It just bounces right off and it gets grabbed and snatched by the enemy and he takes it and he runs with it. We never fully have understanding. We never listen. We never do. We never act. Okay? So I want us to do something this morning. I'd like to invite each and every one of you to stand up with me, all right? So will you please stand up? And we're going to do something. We're going to actually take action this morning, okay? Because this series is about a willingness to hear. And so I'd like you to take that rock and just hold it out right in front of you, okay? Just hold it out there. And I want you to think, all right, you know what? This is my plan. This is my way of doing things. This is my life. And I want you to do something with that, okay? In just a second, we're all going to do it together. We're going to drop this rock on the ground. Don't do it yet, but we're going to drop it. And as we do that, we're saying, Lord, you know what? I am open to receive. I'm open to hear you. I want what you have for my life. And so by dropping that rock, you're saying, Lord, I'm ready. I'm ready to listen. I'm ready to hear. I want to receive your truth, okay? LaGrange, Newnan, let's do this together. Ready on three. One, two, three. Now just leave your hand out there, just like this. Leave it out there. I want you to join your other hand with it. And we're going to pray.